adult Sunday school book. Brother Richard has those available, so raise your hand, wave at him. Your wife needs one. But he's got those available, so just raise your hand. Again, we're putting those out online through email. We're sending those out each week, each lesson. Of course, we're not having Sunday school in services quite yet, but we are trying to kind of work towards that and kind of got some priorities set or some phases that we established in our board meeting. Of course, phase one was start a church. We actually were able to do that on Mother's Day, and so now we're here on Father's Day, and so we've been able to establish our services on Sunday morning. Today, I don't want to ruin the news, but we are doing phase two, which is establishing and starting our children's church back up. And so I'm going to let Brother Tommy come and talk just a little bit about our children's church.
He literally said everything I was going to say.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So, it's okay. We're having children's church again start today. Hold for applause. All right, so the way it's going to work from here on out is thanks to all five of you. The way it's going to work is before church, if you wouldn't mind dropping your kids off, kids as of like elementary school. I know some of you guys have some like adult kids that would drop off upstairs.
But there are
not about five. So, drop them off. We're going to worship. We're going to have games. We're going to have a lesson. And we're going to have arts and crafts. And so when the service is over with, then you can come upstairs and pick them up. All right? That's all I've got. See what I mean?
If you have not got a chance, they've done a little, not really remodeling, but they've done some revamping. They've painted. They've done some stuff to our children's church area. If you have not been upstairs and been up into that area, you need to go look. Just a little bit goes a long ways. And so they've worked on that, kind of preparing for this phase of children's church and establishing that. Wow, it really looks kid friendly. And so we appreciate Stacy and Leanne and their family and Tommy for doing that and kind of making that special. Now we'll mention our next kind of phase and focal point that we are going to be looking at is our Wednesday night Bible study, our midweek Bible study and youth and activities. Of course, our teens are already meeting on Wednesday night, but we are presently watching our Howe County COVID numbers, which we have had a pretty strong escalation over the last couple of weeks of cases that have developed here in Howe County. And so so we're kind of holding off before we start our Wednesday night Bible studies and midweek Bible studies back up and how that's going to look. And so stay in tune. We'll get there, but we're being a little bit precautious right now until those numbers subside a little bit. Brother Richard, if you don't care, since you're up and around, if you don't care to shut those two doors, because Ron Evans will not pay a lick of attention if he can see outside. He's going to be thinking about fishing, and he's going to be thinking about hunting. And so anyway, we appreciate Brother Ron, appreciate all of our ushers. Also, I do want to make mention that the phase four, after we establish our Wednesday night services, then we will transition and begin to look at Sunday school and those types of things. Also, if you need a nursery, we are not staffing our nurseries yet, but if you need the nursery, it is always open and available for you to take your little one, take care of them, and then come back. Or if you need someone to help out, we've got some ladies, if they see you take a little one out, they're kind of on guard, and they'll probably follow you out and ask you if you need someone to help with them. And so that is available in all of our services as well. And so let me make mention of just a few of our prayer requests that we have, and we've got a number of them, but I want to make mention of just pray for Brother Lee Vincent. Brother Lee had 3 stents put in this week. He got his report, I believe it was either Friday, I believe his report was given, and the doctors are very, very pleased with the way everything is going. He's doing very well, and so we're grateful for that. He is being precautious. They said they're going to have church from the couch today on our live stream, and so we certainly understand that, and but continue to pray for Brother Lee as he recovers from that. Also, continue to pray for Junior Brixey. He is, he's been to his doctor. He has to go every Monday now, or every week. He's visiting with his doctor. His blood count has dropped pretty dramatically, and they're pretty concerned about him. And so if you would pray for Brother Junior, and maybe even more so pray for Betty, because she has to put up with Brother Junior. But they are, in all seriousness, they are very concerned about his blood count, and they've got him on some medicines, trying everything that they can to get that built back up. So pray for Brother Junior. And then, of course, also we've had some that have passed away that we want to pray for as well. Of course, Sister Evelyn Wallace's funeral was Monday. Bill Kimbrough's family, Brother Bill's funeral was last week as well. James Hurd family, this is Janice Atkinson's brother who lived in Louisiana. We mentioned him last week. He passed away. His funeral was actually yesterday, and Dennis and Janice and the family are actually traveling back home today from Louisiana, so pray for them as they come back, and pray for the Hurd family as well. And then also pray for James Ray Collins' family. I see, oh, there they are back there. I thought I'd seen you earlier, and I was looking for you, couldn't find you. But Brother James's father passed away Thursday, I believe it was. His funeral will be Tuesday at 10 o'clock at the Howell Memorial, or Howell Valley Cemetery. Howell Valley Cemetery at 10 o'clock on Tuesday. I noticed that there was a visitation on Monday from 6 to 8. Will that be a family visitation or just a viewing?
It's open.
It's open? Okay, all right. So I didn't know for sure. I know for a while they weren't doing visitations. And so Monday from 6 to 8 at Robertson Drago, there'll be a family visitation. And so you're welcome to go and see the family either Monday from 6 to 8. Or again, the funeral will be Tuesday at 10 at Howell Valley. So let's remember those families in prayer, and hold them up as they mourn the loss of their loved ones. Also, it was mentioned to me this morning, Sister Naoma Painter. Bless her heart. She wants to be at church so bad, but she just can't. They did get her out yesterday and ran a few errands and kind of got her out of the house. But last night she fell and kind of boogered up her forehead a little bit. Boogered up. Is that okay for a preacher to say boogered up? I don't know if that's appropriate or not. Anyway, she kind of got a little lump knot there. And so let's pray for Sister Naoma, and that she'll not have any further issues with that. And so pray for her. Any other prayer requests that anyone has that you would like to make mention of? Sister Barb. All right, let's pray for Sister Barb. She's having some difficulty breathing this morning, so let's pray for her. Any others? Brother Bill?
Just a little praise. I think my nephew, after 4 months in the hospital, got to go home Thursday. Still a long way to go recovery-wise, but he's finally out of the hospital.
Amen. Amen. Let's give God praise for that. It is a miracle. He was even able to go home. So, man, I tell you, 4 months of being in the hospital, not in and out of the hospital, 4 months of being in the hospital. And that's just an extraordinarily long time. And so let's just give God praise for that. Any others? Any others? Somebody. Go wrong.
Let's make sure we pray for our country. We need.
Yes. Pray for our country. pray for our country. And let's pray for the lost, because you know what's wrong with our country, right? It's the fact that we don't have Jesus. We get Jesus in the proper place. I'm not talking about you and I. I'm talking about our nation, our country, our world. Jesus being the proper place, a lot of these things. So it's a sin problem. It's not a race problem. It's not a cultural problem. It's not an American problem. It's a sin problem. Amen. And so we need to pray for the lost. Pray for Brother Gale. Brother Gale's going to be preaching this morning, and he gave me the best Father's Day present I could have possibly got. He's preaching for me. And so, Brother Gale, I appreciate you and appreciate you sharing the Word of God. Pray for him as he preaches today. And again, I want to say to all of our fathers, Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day. We're glad you're here today. Any others? Let's stand together, if you would. We'll go to the Lord in prayer. We'll have our praise team come, and they're going to lead us in some worship. This morning, we want you to join in as well. Brother Richard King, Brother Richard, would you care to lead us in prayer, please?
Our Father, as we bow before you today, Lord, we just thank you for the day that you've given us. Lord, just help us that we all would have open hearts, open ears, and hear your word and apply to our lives. We might be better servants to you. Just lead God and direct us in our service today. We want to bring some necessary, a special anointing today. Lord,
You know, we mentioned this just a little bit ago, but the fact is we do. Our country needs a touch from heaven. Our country needs a little touch of reality, a little realization of where we're at, and really, maybe more so, where we're going. And so last week was Flag Day, and I was grateful that it was Flag Day because I tell you, there's a church in town, a good friend of mine, Jerry Heath, pastors there in Jared's church, right there on the bypass. I don't know if you've seen it. Whenever you come around the corner, they've got these two huge flags flying off of their balcony. I thank God that we as a church can acknowledge the country in which we live in. Not every church in every country has that privilege and has that real realization of where our country was established and the greatness of that. Now, I will mention this. I read an article this week. Whenever we recognize our country, our patriotism to our country cannot replace our responsibility as Christians. They're two different things. And last week we did our pledges. We're going to do those pledges again. We've always done our pledges, the American flag, the Christian flag, and then to the Bible. But last week we reversed those, and we're going to reverse them again for good reason, because we need the Word of God first. That is our first responsibility. The Word of God is our first accountability partner that any of us will ever have. And so if you would, if you've got your Bibles, hold them up real high. And just again, we're not acknowledging anything other than the fact that the Word of God is profitable, it is infallible, and it is what is needed in all of our lives and in our country. Would you say the pledge to the Bible with me, if you would, please? I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. Now to the Christian flag. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior whose kingdom it stands. One Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again with life and liberty to all who believe. And now to the American flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Would you bow with us one more time as we pray today? Brother Stan Taylor, would you care to lead us in prayer, please?
Our time, most gracious Heavenly Father, as we humbly come before thee at this time, we thank thee, dear Lord, for the wonderful blessings thou hast bestowed upon us. We thank thee for the privilege of living in this country, where we're able to come and congregate and meet and hear your word proclaimed as we are today. Dear Lord, we know there are many that are sick and afflicted. We just ask, dear Lord, that your loving hand of healing come down and heal their bodies, dear Lord. Dear Lord, we pray for those who have lost loved ones. We ask you to give them strength, give them comfort during this time of loss. Now, dear Lord, we continue on in this service. We ask that you bless each song and song, bless the minister as he comes before us. Gives us your word. Continue guiding and correct us this week. We give you praise and honor and glory for it all. For it's in your Son's name we do pray. Amen.
Amen. Remain standing. How many of you remember when you got saved? How many of you remember whenever you got saved? I can't tell you the day. I almost can. I can't tell you the year. And I can tell you a number of things about what happened whenever I got saved. But the most important thing is I remember getting saved. That born-again experience, that time where I acknowledged my sinfulness to an almighty God who is righteous and who is forgiving. And whenever I acknowledged my sin to him, him, he extended to me grace and mercy that I will never forget. And I remember praying for peace, and God sent that peace, that forgiveness of the sins and the burden of sin that I have carried for over 21 years of my life. But I remember getting saved. I hope this song is a song that you can sing and just simply remember how that you got saved. And if you're not, if you're here today and you need Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, the Redeemer of your soul, what better day than today to give your life to Jesus? This song is entitled, I Got Saved. once again. Father God, we again recognize and realize how good you are. What an appropriate song on Father's Day to sing the praises of our Heavenly Father, acknowledging and recognizing your grace and your mercy and how good you are. Lord, that's who you are. You will never be anything different than a good, good Father. We are redeemed. Those who have applied the blood of Jesus to their sins, that's who we are. We're your children. We thank you for giving us all the privileges of being a child of God. We're so grateful again for another opportunity to worship you today. Lord, I pray that you'll bless Brother Gale as he shares the word of God. Lord, let it be food for our soul. God, let it stir us to a point that we'll see and recognize our need of you and your willingness to come down and meet us where we're at. Thank you, Jesus, for your love, mercy, and grace. In Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's people say,
amen. Amen.
You may be seated. Brother Gale, boy, he is way back there in the back. He's going to come strolling right up here. I tell you, Brother Gale has been such an asset to our church. He has been such a blessing to me. As a senior pastor, he has been nothing more than helpful as one of our associates here. And so, Brother Gale, we're praying really hard that you don't mess everything else up that I've worked so hard. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. We've been praying for Brother Gale. We're looking forward to good, good service. I've been praying for Linda, too. Yes, yes. All right. Brother Gale, hey, give him a hand.
It's good to be here, is it not? When you speak of those words about me, I thought about this man one time. He passed away. If you want to, you can turn to the book of Luke, chapter 24, verse 13. And anyway, he was at his funeral, and his wife and the two boys were sitting there, and the preacher just kept telling what a good man he was and bragging on him. And directly the mother tapped one of the boys on the shoulder, and she said, go up there and look in that casket, make sure that's your daddy there. So that's kind of like what we are, I guess, this morning here. I don't know. And I found out a way to get around long lines in Walmart and grocery store. You're in a hurry, you want to get out. Just say, I'm so glad to get out of New York City for a few days. Called a couple of times and sneezed once. You're at the head of the line. It's amazing what happens to all that. Just kidding. Anyway, thank you all for coming. Father, thank you for a good day you've given to us. Like the psalmist of old said, he said, I was glad when they said, let's go to the house of the Lord. God, thank you for all the modern technology that we've got to have church and services at home. But God, there's nothing like being in your house with your people that we can come before your throne. And Lord, you ordained the church, and you said in the last days, we're not to forsake assembling before all, because you see the day appearing. God, we can come to your house, and we can be filled with songs of praise and worship. We can hear your word and get instruction and help for the weak. But God, we can just see each other, and that's a great encouragement too. And Lord, it's not what we can do today, it's what you can do. And Lord, anoint us and use us for your cause, your kingdom and will, we ask in Jesus' name. And they all said, amen. Amen. I'd like to preach to you this morning. I don't have a podium here. Wow. I'll sit this way. I have to have my hands free to talk. I used to work with a man about 6'4". He was my supervisor. And when he gathered together and had a meeting with us, we all stayed away from him, because the more he talked, the more excited he got. But anyway, I'd like to preach to you this morning, what a difference the presence of Jesus makes.
Yes.
And that's what it's all about, being in his presence today. In the book of Luke, chapter 24, verse 13 says, and behold, two of them went down the same day to the village called Emmaus, which is from Jerusalem about 60 furlongs, about 7.5 miles away. And they're walking, and they talk to the things that have happened. And it came to pass while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them.
Wow.
But their eyes were not open, or holding that they should not know him. And he said unto them, what manner of communications are these that you have one to another as you walk and you're sad? And the one of them, whose name was Cleophas, said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem, and hast not known the things which have come to pass there in these days? And he said unto them, what things? This is Jesus. Can you imagine? This has happened. You thought everybody knew about it. And here's Jesus. He knew too. And he said, what things? And they said unto him concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. Notice verse 21. And said, in whom we trusted that he had been he which should have redeemed Israel. And besides all this, that this is the 33rd day since these things were done. The women have come back and said, he's not there, he's risen. Peter, John checks it out. They just don't get it either. And here these old boys are. Can you just see them walking along the road? They're just thumping gravel with their lower leg, just talking. You know, and here's the key. They said he was our trust. Our hope was in him. Everything laid on him. And now he's dead. What are we going to do? You think about it. All their hope is gone. All their joy is gone. Their future looks pretty dim because the one they trusted in is not there. And all of a sudden, Jesus began to walk with them. And things change. Their life changes. The situation changes because he shows up and he comes on the scene. All at once in verse 32, the Bible said, and they said one to another, did our heart just burn within us while he walked with us on the way? And he opened the scriptures to us. Did their heart, they are on fire again. They run, I think they run back to Jerusalem. I don't think they walk back. They run back down there and they said, you are not going to believe this. They're so excited. The good news is they got to tell somebody. You know what? I think sometimes God needs to ignite a fire in our heart again when we got something to tell somebody in the world we live in. When you first got saved, you couldn't wait to tell somebody about it. You had to share the good news. We need that fire in us again. It's like Jesus is still dead. He's not. He's very much alive in these last days and he controls. If you go to the book of John chapter 4, I'll catch up with you sometime between now and 4 o'clock this evening. First thing is the difference Jesus makes in our lives and his presence. If we could just get in his presence. In Exodus chapter 32, Moses goes up to the mountain. He gets the Ten Commandments from God. He comes back down off that mountain. There's the children of Israel while he's been gone a little while. They have built a golden calf worshiping that thing. I think Moses was upset to say the least. What do you think he was? He broke all the commandments. I guess he was. You might say, like some of you all say, he is mad. Now, none of you all get mad or angry anymore. I know that. We just get upset. So I'll just say Moses was very upset. No doubt, Moses' heart is broken. No doubt, he feels so let down. Look what God's given y'all. And now look how he's repaid. I'm sure all these emotions are running rapid in Moses' heart. But do you know what he did? In chapter 33 of Exodus, verse 18, Moses desired to be in God's presence. Not another miracle. He said, Lord, would you just show me your glory? In verse 21 of that chapter, God said, Moses, there's a place for me. He said, you can't see me, all of me. You'd melt. You'd die. But he said, I'm going to hide you and put up to that rock. When I pass by, I'll take my hand. He saw the hinder part of God. Chapter 34, Exodus. Moses is renewed. The commandments are restored. He comes off that mountain in the presence of God. A different man than he went up there. In the presence of God, it changed his life. He's on fire. He's ready to go again and lead the children of Israel. How many knows those people had not changed one bit? But he had. And I want to share with you something. Sometimes it's not everybody around you that needs to change. Sometimes you and I need to change, not everybody else around. change us, it did Moses in the presence of God. 1 Kings chapter 18. Elijah, Ahab. He met Elijah and he said, it's your fault. We haven't had any rain. You know what? It's always somebody else's fault.
That's right.
You don't believe it, ask your wife. Be careful to ask your wife. She'll tell you the truth and everybody else will butter you up. But anyway, aren't you glad you got a good wife?
Amen.
Fathers, I'll say it again. Aren't you glad you got a good wife? You should reach over and tap your elbow or something to get a free meal. But anyway, it's always somebody else's fault. Dennis has got a skin. Anyway, it's always somebody else's fault, is it not? Worship service ain't what it ought to be. Saints, it's always somebody else's fault. Elijah looked at him, he said, it ain't my fault. Well, he didn't say, ain't they talk proper back then. But he said, I had an English teacher tell me sometimes, she said, ain't in the dictionary. It is now. Anyway, it's their fault. He said, no, it's not. He said, let's just have a showdown and see who's at fault here. So the prophets of Baal, I mean, they leaped on the altar, they cut themselves, they screamed, and one old man, 1 Kings 18 and 30, one old man repaired the altar of God that had been broken down. The communication line had been cut off, the altar was broken down. He repaired the communication line, prayed a little simple prayer, and God showed up. He didn't have to ask for worship. They fell in worship mode immediately. Then he goes to praise in earnest, and the rains come. Chapter 19, God had moved, and I want to share something with you. If God blesses you and he does something great in your life, and you feel like you could run through a troop and jump over a wall like David, be very careful. Satan hates to see you happy. He'll try to knock your feet out from under you the minute he can. Don't go demon hunting. He tries to do that, you've got to realize it's him that's trying to destroy you. Elijah's down for the count, chapter 19, verse 4. He said, my flesh be dead, but he better than my father's. He goes and takes him an out, and the angel of God shows up, feeds him some heavenly food, takes another nap, and then the angel shows up. Hey, that's kind of like preaching on Sunday. Go home, lay before the Lord, and take a nap. But anyway, the angel shows up again in verse 7. He eat that meat and went in it for 40 days and 40 nights. I'm going to tell you something, folks. Too many of us anymore are trying to run on our strength instead of God's strength. He gets in this cave of self-pity. None of you know what that is either. How many of you got a code of self-pity? A code of self-pity. Anybody got any? Four of us have. If you don't have one, I've got a whole closet full of them on you. You don't have a little code of self-pity.
Or the mullet grows, or whatever you want to call it. But if something doesn't happen or go your way,
But the best thing you can do is to get in God's presence. This is the second thing. In His presence, things change. Amen. When you can get in His presence, it brings a whole outlook. You remember these two guys? In their presence, they have no hope. But in His presence, there's a fire in them. There's a hope in them. There's a zeal in them. They're ready to go tell somebody. They're all excited again. Because in His presence, it made everything different. In John chapter 4, I remember that now. I said I'd catch up between now and 4 o'clock. We'd make a better time, I thought. But in John chapter 4, Bible said that Jesus in verse 4, He said, I must go to lead to Samaria. Now, if you're a good free will Baptist person, there is no way on earth you would venture through some places you'd go a day's journey around. The Samaritans, if you're a Jew, you drive, you walk a whole day around Samaria because of those half-breeds there. But Jesus said, I've got to go through there today. He comes to the well of Sychar and He sits down. And here comes this woman out of town. The disciples have went to buy meat. And so here she comes out to the well. I could see this woman every day she'd go get the well. They'd all just look at her. Look at that. Boy, she's messed her life up. I kind of wish she'd moved to another town, wouldn't you? What a disgrace when she walks in there. And she comes to the well, and here's this Jewish guy. And Jesus strikes up a conversation with her. I think she's totally shocked. You're a Jew, and you're talking to me. And he said, oh, yeah. And he said, I know you're hungry and thirsty for something. I know there's something in you that's missing. He said, if you drink this water I got you, and you're thirsty, kid, she said, I'd like to have some of that. And he begins to talk to her. And let us drop down to chapter 4, verse 19. The woman said unto him, sir, I perceive thou art a prophet. Our fathers worship in this mountain. You say in Jerusalem is a place where men are to worship. Jesus said unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem you worship the Father. You worship you know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh and now is when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship Him. God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and truth. And the woman said unto Him, I know that when Messiah come, which is called Christ, when He's come, He'll tell us all things. And Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto you. This woman had been married 5 times, living with the guy. She's not happy. But there has been a hope in her life. She knew one day the scripture said, a Messiah will come. There will be someone comes that has the hope, the answers you need. And she said, when He comes, and Jesus said, I'm Him. Brother, she believed that. She left that water pot. She went to town and she brought the whole town out to hear somebody that knew all about her life, her heart, and her situation. And He loved her and He changed her life and her situation. That's what He can do for anybody that can get into His presence. Look how hopeless blind Bartimaeus was. An old beggar, Mark chapter 10, verse 42, you can read when you get home. He's by the roadside begging, and all at once he hears this commotion, this big crowd, and they're coming down the road, and I have to think, oh, blind Bartimaeus, what's the commotion? They said, it's Jesus of Nazareth. Don't you know when they said that, don't you know He lit up? Don't you know He lit up? He cried out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. They said, they told him to be quiet and hold his peace. Can I tell you how good probably said? Shut up! And it got quiet. And he cried even louder. That would have stopped most of us from saying anything anymore. But he got a little louder. He's got one shot. He's got one chance. And he can't see the look on their faces, their expressions, what they're all thinking. They're looking at him. He cried out louder. And Jesus stopped and He called him. And he went to where Jesus was. He said, man, what do you want? He said, I'd just like to be able to see. He said, it's yours. Your faith has made you whole. It happened because he cried out. You remember the woman with the issue of blood in Mark chapter 5, verse 27, she heard it. 12 years suffered many things, many physicians, didn't get any better, but got worse, a bed broke. And she hears about Jesus. She said, I think if I could just press the touch the hem of his garment, I think it'd be fine. He could heal. Guess what she did? She pressed through. Sometimes we've got to press through our emotions. We've got to press through our feelings. We've got to act on faith that God does love us. He does care about us. We're his children. And he hears and answers our prayers. And we've got to press through that mess. And the minute we do and we touch him, everything is going to be all right. Remember the woman in John chapter 8, verse 1 through 11? You know the outstanding religious people, they've got every verse, every line, and every scripture to kill you with. How many knows there's people who's got every verse, every line that know how to skin you and how to kill you? So they found this woman in the act of adultery. Instead of being sad, they could come out of that little chest preaching out. Jesus, we got the Bible. We got Moses' word. And we got the stones to back the word up with. We're supposed to stone her and kill her. I'm telling you, Jesus, in his presence, he spoke not one word for a minute, but he wrote something on the ground. Whatever it was power packed. The rocks begin. He said, the first one of you dudes without sin, you cast the first stone. Brother, sometimes if we look at our lives the way Jesus was, we couldn't throw one stone, but we'd have to cry for mercy and pray before we spoke one word. We think we're so holy and righteous because we go to church every Sunday morning. Brother, Jesus told that woman at the well, I'm not concerned about the Presbyterian, the Methodist, or the Free Will Baptist. We just need Jesus and forget all the doorknobs and everything else. And they come. But in her presence, none of them could throw them. Aren't you glad you didn't sit on the front seat and get thrown? I can feel them one, I don't know about you. But that's why some people don't sit up front. You can feel the anointing, you don't feel as good on you as it does me. But anyway, this woman, here she is, ashamed to look up. All at once the rocks start hitting the ground and start leaving. Just Jesus and her. Brother, they found first line of scripture. But in the presence of Jesus, she found mercy, grace, and forgiveness in her new life. David did. Aren't you glad you do too? Hallelujah. I don't deserve mercy and grace, and I don't even know why God loves me sometimes, because he's God. Amen. Have you ever questioned how he still loves you? Let's take a survey. Oh, four of us, five of us. I want to face some of you all, God. Amen. How can he still love me? Look at me. That's not God telling you that. That's the devil telling you that. And her life has changed. Yours and mine can be too. Didn't he change the Gadarene's life? Didn't he change the leper's life? Didn't he change the man at the pool of Bethesda? Didn't he change all their lives? The man at the pool of Bethesda, I don't have anybody to help me. I don't know if a psychiatrist could help me. I'm tempted to go see one sometimes and just to see if I can mess him up. I went one time years ago when I was a young man, they said, you need to go see a psychiatrist. Give me $200 an hour and I'd say yes or no. Somebody said, you went to see a psychiatrist? Yeah, I figured out he didn't know any more than I did. Y'all got as quiet then you can hear a mouse drop. I just went one time, I had my money, I could spend more money going fishing, get better therapy than I can. Continue on, we better get out of here before dinner time. But he changed their lives. See, it's not about who you are. It's not about your stature or your name. You remember Zacchaeus was a publican and a sinner and a little guy? But he just wanted to see Jesus. The Bible said he put forth an effort to climb the tree. Jesus kept where he was at. Folks, that's all you got to do is put forth the effort and exercise your faith. God will do the rest. And let's get out of here and close on this. How many of y'all know Jesus is here for you today? He's here for you today. You're not here by accident or chance. Linda and I were out yesterday. We seen a few people. Last night I was seeing some people at an auction in the Lions Club auction in Gainesville. We're never anywhere but chance or accident. Our feet and our lives, we're at by divine providence sometimes. You just need to look for God in your life. So Jesus is here for you today. Now go to John chapter 11. Two sisters have lost their brother, so they said to Jesus. Starts out in that chapter, says Jesus loved Martha and Mary and Lazarus. When they heard that Lazarus is sick and they want you to hurry up and come, he sat 2 more days and waited. Boy, don't that just aggravate you, because Jesus don't move when you snap. You know, there's some people, when they snap their fingers, everybody better move and bow down. Don't it just burn you up when you snap your fingers and that don't work with you? Jesus waited a couple of more days. 4 days later, he comes down to their house, and as soon as Martha heard it, she went out to meet him. And she said, Jesus, if you care about us. Do you ever think Jesus don't care about you sometimes? That's a lie from the pits of hell. Jesus cared so much for you, he died and took your place. He cares so much about you that he never has ever hammered your head every day. He cares so much about you that he'll never leave you forsaken. He'll love you with nobody else give you the time to take. And so they didn't think he cared. And Martha said, I know that whatever you do, whatever you ask God will do it today. And so he said, he told her that. So about verse number 28. Said, when she had said, she went her way, she called Mary, her sister, Cedar, said, the master's coming. He called for me. And as soon as she heard that, she rose quickly and came to him. Jesus was not yet come to town, but was in the place where Martha had met him. So the Jews followed her out there. Here's the key. Martha said, Jesus is here. Jesus is here. Mary, he's calling you. He wants you to come. Brother, she didn't hesitate. Zacchaeus didn't hesitate. Blind Bartimaeus didn't hesitate. We don't need to hesitate either. You know what? It may not happen again. He passed that way one time through Jericho. And just like they told Jairus, they've told them here. Verse 39 of John 11. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of him, said, he's dead unto him, Lord. But this time he's stinking, for he's been dead 4 days. Nothing stinks worse than human decay. Talked to a funeral director one time. This person had been dead several days. And he said, Gil, I sealed that casket with whatever the caulking. And he said, you could still smell the stench. And he said, I finally realized when the screw screws on, there was a little air hole. The stink was so bad. He stinketh. And Jesus said unto her, did I not say unto you, if you believe, you'd see the glory of God today? He said, I told you, if you just believe it, you can see what God's going to do today. And just like Martha panicked, you remember Jairus had come to get Jesus to lay hands on his little daughter? I'm going to tell you something. You'll be surprised how quick you can humble yourself when it comes to your children. You may think you're strong and powerful, till it comes to your little kids. That was his little daughter. He fell at Jesus' feet and saw him to come. On the way, he heals this woman. And the Bible said, here they come. The religious, the rulers of the synagogue. Verse 34, 5, and Mark 5. He yet spake, came from the rulers of the synagogue's house. Certainly said unto them, your little daughter's dead. Your little daughter's dead. I think that's just about how they said it, with a smirk. Your little daughter's dead. Why bother the master anymore? You know, Satan whispers in your ear, Jesus don't care about you. He don't care about you. He cares about your brother and sister. He don't care about you. When Jesus heard that, he said, don't you be afraid now. He said, believe me. Yeah, I always trust you. You come to get me and you trust me. And folks, those men lost their trust in Jesus and their little best. Whatever you do, don't ever lose your trust in God's word and his promises to you. He will fulfill that. You hang on to it. Jesus goes into the Jesus said, "Hush, you sleep." They laughed, kept us going. You know what Jesus did? He took all them Bible thumpers and religious people and got them out of the house. He took mom and dad in there. "Oh, Brother Wooten, he should have brought 10,000 people in there to see." You know what? That's what's wrong with a lot of religious people. They didn't get everybody else to see them. Right. Jesus cleared the house out. He took Peter and John, mom and dad. He went in there where that little girl was, and he said some kind of word. And he said, "Would you turn the damsel to rise?" And that little 12-year-old girl sat up in that bed. Jesus said, "Give her something to eat. She's hungry." Don't you know mom and dad's heart's not broken anymore? Don't you know there might have been just a little excitement in that house that day? Kind of like Martha and Mary. They come to the tomb, and Jesus looked at that tomb, and first of all, he thanked God that he heard him. How many of you ever start out, "God, I just want to thank you so much you're here with me. I know you love me. I know you hear me. I know you care about me." But most of us start out like this. "Oh, God. Oh, Lord. Oh, you just cared about me, Jesus. If you just love me, Lord." Well, let's just start out how we start out. But Jesus started out thanking his Father that he always heard him. And after he got through thanking God, and all the things that are going on, verse 43, he said, "Thus spoke." He cried with a loud voice. He said, "Lazarus, come forth." And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot, grave clothes, his face bound with a napkin. Jesus said, "Loose him and let him go." And many of the Jews which came to Mary and Martha heard these things believed on him. Don't you? Hey, I could probably figure out how that happened. Can't you then? When Lazarus come out of that tomb in them grave clothes, and Jesus said, "Let him go," don't you know Mary and Martha said, "Wow, that's pretty good." How do you think they reacted? How would you have reacted? Don't you know that Mary and Martha, don't you know the dust was blowing? Don't you know they run to where Lazarus was, told their arms were, I think they may have. I can't prove it by the scripture, but I can prove it by me. How many of you would have embraced them and hugged them and run to him? Amen. All fear and doubts gone. They're excited. Lazarus is alive and well, and they're doing fine too. And I want you to know that's all Jesus can do for you. He's here for you. He speaks to you. Could be he's calling you, but you've got to respond to him. Jesus said, "Come all that labor and heavy laden, I'll give you rest." Jesus gives invitation after invitation. We just sit there. But he can help us.
Right.
What if blind Bartimaeus would have said, "I think I'll wait till Jesus comes through town the next time"? What if the woman with the issue of blood said, "Well, I'm a nobody. Can't go to church because I've got a blood issue. Jesus just don't care about me." But they didn't wait for the next time. When he asked Zacchaeus to come down out of that tree, now you'll have to excuse me, I used to say a thing. I think Zacchaeus came down out of that tree like a gray squirrel did. You ever seen a gray squirrel excited to come out of the tree? I think that's how he came out of that tree. Bark was flying. He goes to Jesus' house. He says, "Zacchaeus, here's why I came to planet Earth, to seek and to save the lost." He didn't come to make me feel good, though he does sometimes. He didn't come to make me be a full fatter. He didn't come to make you look better. He come to save your soul, because you can't save yourself. Only he can. And the book of Revelation closes out in chapter 22, verse 17. "Surely if you'll come, please." And the Spirit of the bride said, "Come, and let him that hears say, come. And let him that's athirst come, and whosoever will, let him come and drink of the water of life freely." Everything Jesus has for you, your salvation, he paid for. Your healing, he paid for. It's all free. But see, Jesus can knock on your heart's door. But he can't come in if you don't ask him. He said, "Behold, I stand at your heart, and I knock on your door." But you won't open the door. You won't let me come in. Jesus said, "If you'd open that door," he said, "I'll come in suddenly. I'll come in fellowship with you." Jesus said, "I'd change your life. I could change your situation." He said, "I'd do everything you can do. But you won't ask me. You won't believe me. You won't even come to me when I come in now." there's all kinds of seats up here empty in the front. They'll be good altars. They're soft and padded. Stand. I'll make it as easy as I can this morning. Lord, Pastor, thank God for a great job helping us be the Lord and trustees ahead to help this church through this situation as we're going through. Thank God. Folks, there's some things your pastor can't do, and I can't do it. I know somebody who can. He can change your hopelessness to hope. He can change your situation. He can change your life. You just fall in his lap. Fall in the mercy and grace. These seats are open. It's not what I did for you. And you might as well quit wearing them all on people's face. You're not the ones hurting them. They're not the ones hurting you. If you need Jesus, you need him to do something for you today. But I'm convinced, cried out, and he said, you put your faith in action, I can do this. She put her faith in action. Sometimes you have to put your faith in action. You take one step and he'll meet you. First of all, if you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you've heard about what he can do, all I can ask you to do is give him a chance. He can change your life. You've got some situations in your life. Why don't you just come fall in his lap this morning and say, Jesus, I sure do need you this morning. And you come to him. You're not coming to me. You're coming to bow before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Does anybody need to come this morning? Thank you for coming and maybe seeing the pastor in yours. We love you. Thank you for listening.
Dear God, we just